So without further ado, please welcome my wonderful colleague and friend, Dr. Goldberg.
Thanks, Dr. Li Wen, and thank you to the Department of Epidemiology for making space for me to be able to present on this. I'm excited to be able to do so. I know that I've had the great privilege of doing quite a bit of work and presentations with racism and anti-racist work in CSPH and in the Department of Epi. So for those of you who've heard me warble on about this before, there will be some new things in here, I promise, okay? So it's not just sort of rehashing the same kinds of things repeatedly, I promise, okay? So in particular, we're going to spend some time talking about history. That's mostly what we're going to do today. And just a little bit of a turn at the end to application, right? Which was okay, the so what does this mean for us at the present? So I was fortunate to be asked maybe about 10 days ago to give a talk for the Department of Biostatistics, and they were also interested in thinking collectively about race and racism. And I sort of, one of the constructs, the ways in which I sort of started that talk is something I'd like to do here as well. And this is a quote from a woman named Dorothy Roberts. If you don't know who Dorothy Roberts is, so she's a law professor at Northwestern, and she's the author of a book called Killing the Black Body and several other books. And she's definitely one of the foremost living authorities on racism and American medicine and public health in particular. And so she's a leader in these spaces, and it's important if you're interested in this subject in general, you really should be checking out some of Dorothy Roberts' work. She's the co-author, the sort of co-founder along with Jonathan Metzl, who's at Vanderbilt, on the idea of structural competency as an educational tool, right? Which the School of Medicine is interested in. I'm engaged in some of the curriculum reform efforts in the School of Medicine, and we're talking a little bit about structural competency, training health professionals to be competent in thinking about structure. And she has this really sort of, I think, important idea that race is the product of racism. Racism is not the product of race. Well, what does that mean? And I sort of think one of the things we want to do when we talk about racism is to contextualize it historically, which is partly the point of today's seminar, right? But really, you know, thinking back, it's not like on the eighth day, the deity handed down the concept of racism, right? It actually has a history. And I'm trained as an intellectual historian, which means I'm especially interested in ideas. How do ideas travel? How do they animate things, right? How do they move social activity? How do they make us think certain things, right? And so the idea here is the concept of racism in particular, and race, racial categories in their Western incarnations actually has a history. It's about 500 years old, which isn't to say we didn't see differences between groups of people before that. That's probably human in many ways, right? But this idea of racism as a particular social category in Western societies really starts to take root in the early modern era. It coincides, not coincidentally, by the way, with the age of migrations and explorations and greater contact between white peoples in the old world and black and brown peoples, right, in the quote-unquote new world. And so the idea here is because of structural racism, this is what Professor Roberts is referring to, right, that people in the early modern and then into the modern era, and in terms of timing, we're talking about 16, 1700s, and then the modern era begins, most historians think, right about the year 1800s, where we start to talk about the modern era, right? And so the idea is people started to notice, how could they not notice, right, the stark differences in health. And so here we're talking about health and inequalities already, in health and other social conditions between white people and black and brown peoples in particular, right? And so they needed some way to account for these differences. And the construct that they developed was this idea of race, right? So first came racism. This is Professor Roberts' point. First, we have unequal and structurally violent institutions, right? And if you'd want to think about colonialism and imperialism, it's hopefully not that difficult to think of what those violences might look like, right? And so these kinds of structural violence created differences between groups of people, and we needed in the West in particular some way to account, right, for these differences. And the idea of race and the idea, for example, of blood quantum, right, that race is rooted in biology really begins to take root at this time, right? And so thinking a little bit more deeply about these ideas of racism and biological essentialism, of course, there's the famous eugenics tree. You may have seen that picture before. That's obviously much later. That's a mid to late 19th century picture, okay? So clearly in the 16th century, in the 1500s, the 1600s, they obviously didn't have the same concepts of heredity that we started to develop in the modern era, right? In the mid to late 1800s, and Gregor Mendel and the Pease and, you know, all those things, right? They didn't have that, but they still had this idea that racism was rooted in people's bodies, right? And so in the 1600s and the 1700s, they centered on blood, for example. And that's still where we get these ideas of blood quantum, which is a fundamentally racialized concept. So what's the point of all this in thinking about germ, as we're going to move to talk about germ theory? When we think about racism and medical and scientific projects and public health, which is part of this story, it's critical to understand that medical and scientific concepts are not a branch on the tree of racism, right? They are core to the entire project of racism in the West. Racism, the way it looks today, structural and systemic racism, would look very different if it didn't have sort of medical and scientific concepts and resources, and yes, medical and scientific men, largely men, of course, right, that had rooted sort of their ideas about racism in these concepts, right? So colonialism, imperialism, and there's a lot of really great work on this in the history of public health, especially in the history of global public health. For those of you who work on global health in particular, there's a lot of really excellent work on this going back at least 500 years. The point is, this idea of biological essentialism is fundamental to racism. What's biological essentialism? It's the idea that there's some essence that's rooted in the biology of people's bodies by which we can differentiate, right, racism, by which we can differentiate the races. It has been a fundamental component of racism in most of its Western incarnations for at least half a millennium, right? And so this idea, I'd love you all to keep in mind, this idea of biological essentialism is old and it's deep and it's powerful as a construct and idea. And so, for example, in the talk I gave for the Department of Biostatistics, we spent just a little bit of time talking about where genetics and genetic epidemiology and genomics fits into this. And this isn't to trash genetics, so please don't yell at me for this, okay? But there are many, many scholars who work on racism and health and racism and public health who, you know, there are some traps and pitfalls we can fall into when we start to discuss genetics and genomics, because it looks like it can be used to continue this centuries-long tendency of biological essentialism. So let's keep that in mind as we sort of move into our larger discussion of germ theory in particular. So for those of you who have seen some of my talks on this since March, you've seen this slide. Like I said, I promise there will be new things, but you've seen this slide in particular. And this is one of the underlying messages that I have found really, really important, right, to really get across, is that structural and systemic racism is unquestionably a product of historical patterns of domination, oppression, and subordination, right? It's rooted in power. It's rooted in social capital, which, of course, is a concept that epidemiologists, social epidemiologists study in particular, right? And so there's this idea that I see sometimes that one of the things we do, and we're guilty of this, especially on health sciences campuses, if we have a problem, we're going to try to educate our ways out of it, right? And I'm an educator. I'm giving this talk. I think this is good. But I really think it's important to understand that racism is not even mostly a function of health and scientific ignorance, right? The reasons why we engage in these things and we perpetuate structural racism and structural violence, I don't think is really well supported by the idea that it's a function of the misunderstanding, for example, of the pathophysiology of disease, right? And if we just understood, for example, how coronavirus spreads between people, we wouldn't have the invidious anti-Asian racism, right? The invidious structural racism that we see in how coronavirus is impacting BIPOC communities, in particular in the U.S. So I think it's really important to get ourselves away from that notion. We'll talk a little bit more about it. But one of the examples that I've often used when I've talked about the bubonic plague outbreak in San Francisco in 1900, which impacted overwhelmingly residents of Chinatown and Chinese people in San Francisco, is this idea that racism easily crosses causal attributions, right? It wasn't the case that we had different ideas about how disease, infectious disease, would spread, and then we get new and we think more scientifically accurate ideas with the advent of germ theory, so that we would tend to think racism would diminish if it really was mostly a function of scientific and health illiteracy. That's just not true, right? In the 1870s, so-called miasma theory dominated medical and lay understandings of infectious disease, right? So people in San Francisco and California refer to the foul and disgusting vapors in Chinatown. They called it a laboratory of infections. This racism passed very easily through, though, to germ theory in the 1880s and the 1890s. And that's where we're going to sort of spend the bulk of today's session really talking about, right, is what do we see in the first quarter of the 20th century, right, in what's referred to as the progressive era in the U.S. in particular. How does the advent of germ theory, the idea, and you'll hear this over and over and over again, we've heard it with coronavirus, right? Germs don't know color lines, right? We've heard that over and over again. That was actually a phrase, an idea that begins to take root here, right at this time, in the first quarter of the 20th century. How does that interact? How does that engage with this sort of structural and systemic racism with which the U.S. has been stamped from the beginning? Right. So there are a number of examples we can use when we talk about this. Right. So this is a picture of what was known as the lung block in Baltimore. OK, in the early 20th century U.S. There's a great book on this if you're interested. It's actually called Infectious Fear. It was written by a historian at Columbia, named Samuel Kelton Roberts. And he writes a lot about this. Right. And so the basic idea here, sorry about this, is that Black people were widely depicted as sources of contagious disease, right? And they became prime targets for public health surveillance in Baltimore in the first few decades of the 20th century. First, this surveillance was pushed by local charities, largely white charities, of course, and then it was pushed by the Baltimore City Health Department. And this sort of pushing and this idea of inherent infectiousness and contagion in Black communities in early Baltimore, it eventually actually paved the way for a move to coercive and mandatory institutionalization of Black people in Baltimore. They were moved to the only two Black facilities run by the state of Maryland at the time, which was called Henryton Sanatorium and the Crownsville Mental Hospital, right? And so the basic idea is, again, that, you know, of course, how can you explain the drastically different health inequities, right? The differences in health outcomes in tuberculosis between Black people and white people in early 20th century Baltimore. I mean, you all obviously know the answer to this. We know why tuberculosis spreads more in some communities than others. It has everything to do with structural violence. It has everything to do with deprivation, right? But the public health authorities at the time, which included many public health scientists and early epidemiologists, of course, they were absolutely convinced in the truth of the, quote, incorrigible Black consumptive, right? The idea that there was something about being Black, being a Black person, that made someone sort of biologically susceptible to tuberculosis. And that's what explained the differences we saw between white and Black people, right? So this, again, it's not that they didn't know by the first few decades of the 20th century that TB was contagious and was spread by germs, the mycobacteria. Of course, they knew that, but it really didn't change the extent to which they had a racist and a racialized view of these health inequities and the public health interventions that followed, with significant impact, of course, for Black people in Baltimore at the time. I wanted to bring this to your attention because if you'll note, I don't know if you can see my little mouse up here, this was actually published a couple days ago, to be honest with you, right? So this comes out of Baltimore, right? In particular, this is Aya Nuruddin, Graham Mooney, and Alexander White, who are all affiliated with the Institute for the History of Medicine at Johns Hopkins University in particular, right? And this is their paper. It's in Lancet. It's open access, I think, because I was able to access it pretty easily. But this is a great paper. It's a relatively quick read. I strongly encourage you to check it out. Graham Mooney in particular is a well-known historian of public health and almost a health geographer. So he's really one of the world experts on this. And he puts it this way. I think this is a great quote. They put it this way. Infectious disease risk in Black communities has often been used historically as justification for forced home removals, increased surveillance, often accompanied by police violence, and unsolicited medical interventions, as well as calls for racial residential segregation. They do actually talk about the lung block. And of course, although we're primarily talking about anti-BIPOC racism here in this talk today, so Black, Indigenous, and Brown peoples in particular, there were, of course, lung blocks in many other cities in the US in the early 20th century. And the lung block in New York City, for example, was associated primarily with Jewish, Irish, and Italian immigrants, right? So these ideas, though, is that racism easily, again, crosses these different kinds of causal attributions. And then the advent of germ theory and the idea, of course, that germs and contagion can come for us all, regardless of racial patterns, right, really didn't change that much the extent to which racisms and racialized ideas about disease and health persisted into the early quarter of the 20th century. And unfortunately, public health authorities and officials and public health scientists were all too often eager and willing participants in these kinds of structures, right? So again, just sort of ticking off some sources for those of you who are interested in pursuing some of this inquiry on your own. This is a really wonderful paper, and I'll be drawing from it a little bit in the time that's remaining to me today. This is by Andrea Patterson, who's a historian of science, and she talks about germs and Jim Crow, the impact of microbiology and increased microbiologic understanding on public health policies in the progressive era in the South, in the American South, is what she's talking about in particular. That's a picture of a black doctor's office, a doctor's office for black people, because of course they were segregated. This is in Mississippi in the 1930s in particular, right? And so I think, again, sort of tracking this general theme, you know, one of the funny things about racism, right, is that it is a sort of extraordinarily powerful heuristic, right? And what I mean is it can be used to explain and account for almost anything we see, including health inequities and differences, because at the same time in the US, we have, it is very common, and you can find lots of examples about this, and Dr. Patterson talks about it in her paper, and Dr. Roberts talks about it in his book, right? But that Black people were simultaneously, at the same time in sort of US space, in US history, they were simultaneously regarded as impervious to some infectious diseases. I gave a talk recently where I talked about how problematic this was, for example, in the yellow fever outbreak of Philadelphia in 1793, where the leaders, including Benjamin Rush, for example, were utterly convinced that Black people in Philadelphia at the time were impervious and were immune to yellow fever. And so even though there were a whole bunch of healthcare workers and doctors who were fleeing Philadelphia at the time, Benjamin Rush was convinced, and he tried to convince Black leaders that they should stay in Philadelphia and take care of sick people because they were the ones who were immune. As you can imagine, this had some devastating consequences for the Black community in Philadelphia at the time, who of course were not in any way immune or impervious to yellow fever. We also saw this with regard to polio. There was a widespread belief in the first half of the 20th century in the US, that Black people were regarded as impervious or immune to these kinds of things. For those of you who are interested in pain, and I think some of you all who are familiar with me know pain is actually probably my central area of expertise. I've been working on inequalities in pain for about 10 to 15 years now. We know that this is a very sort of old and damaging trope in American society, the idea that Black people in particular are less sensible to pain than white people, right? That's not an infectious disease, but the trope is the same. And yet we see at the same time, Black people were theorized to be hyper susceptible to others, right? So the idea is that they were seen as sort of reservoirs of infectious disease like syphilis, right? And tuberculosis was another one in which Black people were thought to be particularly susceptible. I mean, I don't mean to make light of this, but the idea is that racism is a heck of a drug, right? And that we can actually use it to explain completely contradictory ideas, even given the increasing sort of and better collection of vital statistics and demographics that documented these kinds of racial health inequities, no matter what we would find. If we would find lower rates for Black people and BIPOC communities in particular, Black, Indigenous, and Brown communities, that could be explained by racism and by racialized ideas. And if we found racial health inequities in which there were elevated rates of disease for Black communities in the US in particular, Indigenous, Brown communities, then we could also explain that in terms of hypersusceptibility. It really didn't matter. Again, this idea is that racism is such a powerful organizing and structural phenomenon, we can easily synthesize and integrate our own public health science, our own findings, our own statistics into these racist and racialized categories that are already formed, right? Now, I want to stop for a minute and although this isn't a formal sort of history talk, and I know we're not trying to sort of do history here, you know, we do want to think a little bit like historians. And, you know, historians often want to, what we do is we contextualize things, and context is complex, right? And so there's no question, right, that despite the invidious racisms that we've been talking about, African Americans did benefit from public health interventions post-1900. And we have some pretty good evidence that they benefited, that African American and Black communities benefited, even when these public health interventions were actually intended only for white people. How did this happen? Well, there are some answers to this. So in the South in particular, despite invidious racism, in terms of our patterns of racialized residential segregation in particular, Southern cities were actually less segregated geographically than they are at the present time. That's a sobering thought for the moment, and we should sort of stop there to take note of how much racial segregation there is in our cities. But partly because they were less segregated than our cities are at the present time, when white citizens and white-led governments in particular would launch public infrastructure and sanitation projects in particular, they also benefited Black people, right? And because Black people were actually less likely to be able to afford sanitation in the early 20th century than white people, Black people were actually able to harness a disproportionate share of the benefits from these public works and sanitation projects. And so in particular, between 1900 and 1925, you can see dramatic health improvements, even among Black communities in the South and in the US, in the East Coast and the US in particular, on the basis of waterborne disease. And obviously we're talking primarily about typhoid, although basic diarrhea, of course, and dysentery is also very important in these things. So you can see dramatic improvements, even given all this racism. The flip side of it is that despite these improvements, even half-hearted efforts, right, to improve the health of BIPOC and Black communities in particular in the US was still marked by invidious racism. Dr. Patterson talks about this. There were well-known reports in which certain public health interventions could be justified because they were, quote, needed to protect white women. And we won't go into the long and devastating history of which fears about white women, which has been referred to as, quote, white women's tears, right, has prompted all sorts of terrible structural violence against Black people in particular. Particular in the U.S., right? So it's sort of a mixed bag, right? And we sort of have to complexify the context a little bit. One of the other points that I've been making, we won't have a lot of time to talk about it, but one of the other points that is really important to people who do what's called social history is we really want to understand, although we want to spend a lot of time talking about oppression and marginalization and structural violence, there is a trap there, right? And that trap is that we don't want to suggest that marginalized and oppressed communities historically are simply substrates to be acted upon, right? That they are simply victims and victims of white dominated racism, although they are, right? What we know when we look at the history of marginalized communities in general is that resistance and agency is always part of the story. Even the most marginalized and oppressed communities find ways to resist. They find ways to reclaim agency, even in the midst of devastating structural racism, right? So for example, I teach in some of my courses, I teach the story of what Jewish people were able to do in several different ghettos, right, under the Third Reich. So there's good evidence of this in the Vilna ghetto. We have some new evidence coming out from what was able to happen in the Warsaw ghetto, right? And what the people in these ghettos, the Jews in these ghettos, were able to do in terms of preventing the spread of infectious and communicable disease under devastating circumstances of deprivation, right, and anti-Semitism is absolutely unbelievable. And we see this over and over and over again. And so Black communities in the US in the early 20th century, they actually harnessed this fear of contagion, right? It was, of course, true, and people understood by the first few decades of the 20th century that germs could spread beyond color lines, that they could spread outside of racial residential segregation patterns, right? And so Black communities actually were able to harness this fear of contagion in order to urge public health action, right? And so that's part of the story as well, this idea of agency and resistance. And I think I would be remiss in talking about these kinds of subjects if we didn't sort of make that little reminder, right? That marginalized and oppressed communities no matter what they've experienced, will always find ways to resist and to seek agency. And in many ways, right, many of these communities have been remarkably successful in doing so. Aya Nuruddin, Graham Mooney's, and Alexander White's article that I mentioned earlier, they have a section where they talk about this resistance, especially from Black communities in the US in the 20th century. Nevertheless, public health and public health works and projects easily assimilated these racialized concepts of disease, right? So in Louisville, a Black physician who was also a sanitary inspector was actually fired. He was terminated from his job because he fumigated a white person's home, right? And so Dr. Patterson points out that public health projects could, in the end, only be successful in the South if they maintain the color line, right? So the idea that germs cross color lines, that contagion doesn't know sort of racial and racialized boundaries, was totally insufficient in the face of the power of structural and explicit racism, right, to change the way that even public health actors in the South were able to ask, right? This is part of our history and our legacy as public health professionals. And I think it's really important for us to own this and to think about it and talk about it sort of moving forward. And it's actually part of the legacy of medical mistrust that BIPOC communities continue to have of medical, scientific, and health officials in the US. And I've been talking about this in terms of the problems this poses for effective treatments and effective public health interventions for coronavirus, right? So this is a huge problem for thinking about the possibility of a potential coronavirus vaccine moving forward, right? And so these things are part of our legacy. Part of the other important idea that I think here is, you know, the idea of racism, right, and classism in particular, right, the ways in which race and wealth interact in the US. Obviously, this is an enormous topic, right, on which there have been huge amounts of things written. But I think it's really important just to sort of say, in the context here where we're talking about germ theory and public health in the first quarter of the 20th century in the US, is that we can easily see how racism persists across class, right? Of course, we know that race and wealth, race and socioeconomic position are deeply, inextricably linked in the US, but we have excellent contemporary evidence from social epidemiology that even when we are able to control for differences in socioeconomic position, we find dramatic health inequalities, right? Racial health inequalities in the US, right? So even wealthy BIPOC people live on average, for example, there are some studies that show they live on average 2 to 3 years less, right, than similarly situated white people, right? And so this is talked about as well. So this is The Crisis, which was a journal that was mostly founded by Du Bois, for those of you who don't know about this, right? And you can see that it's called The Crisis because reasons, right? In one of these issues of The Crisis, I don't think it's the February 1911 issue. This was just the picture I was able to find on the internet, right? Even for those of us able to pay, hospital doors are half closed in our faces, right? And there is a classic example, right? It isn't just enough to be wealthy, even for the very sort of the sort of very few members of BIPOC communities who were able to earn a reasonable living, right? The structures of structural and invidious racism in healthcare and in public health continue to have a deleterious impact on their lives, the lives of their families and communities, right? So really just important to keep that in mind, especially as we think about contemporary issues, we think about contemporary management of infectious diseases, although it's really important to think about socioeconomic position and the ways in which SEP and wealth and income intersect with racism. They're not the same, okay? And that it looks like racism continues to have a strong impact on health outcomes, even when we're able to control for these kinds of things, right? So thinking about the ways in which, in particular, descriptive epidemiology, right? And this is what's really happening in the first few decades of the 20th century, right? Our descriptive epi is starting to get better and better. It's starting to get more and more sophisticated, right? Departments of local health departments are starting to have bigger and bigger components and more resources to devote to the collecting of these sort of vital health statistics, right? So we know that structural racism and deprivation produced then, as it does produce now, these devastating racial health inequities. The problem is that white people in particular have historically used these differences, there's our sort of vital statistics klaxon, right, as evidence of the biological inferiority of Black, Indigenous, and Asian peoples, right? So the idea is that even the descriptive epi itself, the data isn't neutral. The data never actually speaks for itself, right? It can be and has been wielded in these dangerous and these invidious ways, right? They can be used to ground these kinds of racist and racialized narratives that we've seen are actually quite old, right? That we can see these differences. Well, we see racial health inequities, right? It must be because of the biological inferiority of these peoples. We saw this, for those of you who've heard me talk a little bit again about bubonic plague in 1900 in San Francisco, the idea that Chinese people were seen as biologically inferior to white residents in San Francisco has been around, was documented since at least the 1840s and 1850s in California at the time. And the fact that plague pretty much spread in Chinatown and affected almost exclusively Chinese people was just taken as confirmation of this kind of biological inferiority, right? So thinking deeply about how we use data, how we use descriptive epidemiology in the face of an outbreak in infectious disease is really important. And I'll actually come back to that as a sort of closing note here in a few slides. Other things to note, and yes, this is the most shameless of self-promotions. I mean, could I do it any better than this? I mean, this is both shameful and shameless. But, you know, in the age of coronavirus, we're hearing a lot of talk about how public health and public health policy has become politicized, and that we really shouldn't try to do that, right? And I want to push back a little bit against this idea, right? I've been sort of talking about this for most of the seminar so far. But I've argued, and I believe this fundamentally, that public health is always political. And that includes descriptive epi, that includes ID epi, that includes the collection of vital statistics. These things don't speak for themselves. They can't. They don't. Right? There isn't this sense of sort of scientific neutrality that exists separate and apart from these kinds of things. For those of you all who don't know, that idea is kind of axiomatic into the fields from which I come, right? So if you do science and technology studies, if you study the history of public health in the philosophy of science and philosophy of public health, this is pretty standard, right? The idea that there isn't sort of this neutral viewpoint from nowhere. The reasons that I go into in this article, just the very specific reasons why I argue that public health is always political and politicized, is because public health is always a creature of regulatory and administrative structures, right? It's always about agencies. It's always about local health departments, right? And of course, anytime you start to talk about any kind of modern administrative state, so we're talking about at least a couple hundred years at this point, you're always talking about politics. For anyone who has any experience with regulations and agency work and administrations, the whole thing is political. That's the point. It's completely inescapable, and it would be ridiculous if you were involved in regulatory work to suggest that we should keep the politics out of it. Right now, that isn't, let me hasten to add, that isn't an endorsement of some of the particular politics that has been happening in the pandemic and epidemic response in the US. Not at all, right? Just because it's political doesn't mean it's good politics, right? In fact, that's actually my point, right? If it is political, then we're going to need some political and social solutions to bad politics that's impeding our response, right, to the coronavirus outbreak. And in particular, that's really sort of showing and revealing and is having a, you know, the devastating inequalities and structural violences and structural racism that we see. It's not only sort of showing that, again, people who were watching and are aware of these histories knew exactly what was going to happen, by the way, when coronavirus started to spread in BIPOC communities in the US, right? There was no question. It was very sort of easily predictable, and they did predict it. And of course, it's come to pass, right? So of course, we need a politics to deal with this as part of the point, right? And if we just say we have to be above politics, then we're not going to use the social and political tools we have to deal with this. The other point I make in the paper is the historical evidence in modern public health shows it's always been political beyond a shadow of a doubt, right? And so if you're interested in this, that's another talk, and we can talk about this some other time. But just sort of pushing back on the idea that one of the ways we can counter sort of racism, germ theory, racism, and infectious disease in this country is to try to be apolitical about it. I really don't think that that's a good idea, right? I think that that's extremely unlikely to be successful. some other things, and I sort of mentioned this in general. Why do I have a background of happy flowers in a window box? For those of you who know this, this of course refers to Camara Phyllis Jones's wonderful allegory of the gardener's tale, which is, I think, still one of the single best ways we have and I have found of explaining what it means to think about racism as a structural and systemic phenomenon. We don't tend to think well structurally in the US. We have an individualistic political culture and we tend to think individualistically. And by the way, that's also been a problem in public health. And I've written about that as well. So for example, a disturbing percentage of our public health interventions still depend on the individual as the unit of change. That's not a good idea from an efficacy standpoint. It's also not a good idea from a health inequity standpoint. And we can talk about that in the Q&A if you want, right? Right. And of course, we still do a lot of studies in epidemiology and public health science where we try to get at group and structural level phenomenons by aggregating measures that are designed for individuals. That's a methodological problem as well. There are limits on how well we can use those kinds of things. So just reminding this idea that increased scientific and health literacy, I don't think, and you may disagree, and that's okay, because this is to some extent a matter of opinion, right? I mean, I think I have good evidence for my belief, but that's okay. We could probably disagree about this. I don't think it's a good anti-racism intervention, right? Again, I really don't think the way to deal with structural problems is through educations and trainings, although I'm in favor of seminars like this one. We should keep doing it. So thank you all for this. The idea that that's really going to move the needle much on these upstream sort of structural macro social problems, I don't think we have a lot of good evidence for that. So let me hasten to add that, of course, health literacy is a good. I'm 100% and strongly in favor of intervening in ways to improve and increase health literacy, but it is not a good anti-racism intervention. It may be good for all sorts of other things, so we should include it in our intervention bundles, our policy bundles, but it's not the answer, right? Racism is not even mostly, as far as I'm concerned, a function of scientific and health and misunderstanding. This talk has really been about the ways in which our increased scientific and health understandings of infectious and communicable disease has traveled very easily and comfortably with racism against BIPOC communities in the US in particular, right? These two entities have been very happy travelers together, right? Racism is a product of historical patterns of domination, oppression, and subordination. And it's those patterns, it's that power differential. That's what we're going to have to address if we really want to do better, right? And so I am not I'm an Americanist. I mostly study public health, medicine and public health in Anglophone contexts, so the US and Great Britain and England in particular. But there are many, many wonderful, excellent historians of global public health and tropical medicine. And from what I have read, although I'm not an expert in those fields, I do try to read as much as I can in global public health and the history of global public health. And if we want to talk about the history of colonial public health and tropical medicine, the histories are just as bad, if not worse, okay? So again, it's not the case that, well, in the US, because we have a particular history with anti-Black racism, anti-BIPOC racism in particular, you know, maybe it's worse here, but it's better in other places. The histories here in terms of how well racism has functioned to coexist with the advent of germ theory and increased epidemiologic understanding, I don't think that's true at all. I don't think the historical record supports that, right? The histories of places like India and Great Britain and Australia and Great Britain are terrible. And of course, Africa, the many different histories of African colonialism, imperialism, about public health, not good histories there as well, right? So we see the same kinds of things happening over and over again, okay? So we're barreling towards the end because I want to make sure we have some time for Q&A. Just keep an eye on my time there. So what are sort of the takeaways for thinking about this? And I've been trying to sort of link some of this analysis to the pandemic and coronavirus sort of throughout the seminar today, but just sort of turning towards us, what do we take away about this? The first is that public health science is no more neutral than any other aspect of public health, and hopefully the historical record has made this very clear. I really don't think that idea of thinking about public health as quote-unquote this sort of mythical, neutral, objective phenomenon, I don't think it's accurate conceptually. It's certainly not accurate historically, and I don't think it's really going to help us in thinking about how we might deal with the effects of structural and systemic racism that we see every day right now with an out-of-control pandemic in our country. Epidemiology and public health science is implicated in this long history of medical and scientific racism, which again isn't just a limb on the tree of structural racism, it's a root. it's core to the entire project, right? Racism as it exists today wouldn't look the way it does if we didn't have sort of medical and scientific concepts, personnel, and resources that have been involved with it from the very beginning. And I sort of want to end on this last point in particular, because I was talking to some colleagues about this one on Twitter. For those of you who know me, you know I'm pretty active on Twitter as a professional tool, right? So documentation of racial health inequities can be problematic if it's not linked to causal inference arising from structure. What does that mean, right? What does that mean? Well, we can document, and we've gotten pretty good at it in public health, and that's a good thing, because it is important, of course, to document racial health inequities. The documentation of these in and of itself, if we're not supporting or directly making, for those of us who are in a position to do so and who feel comfortable doing this, causal inferences that directly sort of directly state or imply or at least argue for the idea that these racial health inequities, these devastating racial health inequities that we see are without a doubt a function, are caused by structural violence, structural and systemic racism, right? These documentations can be used in problematic ways. And I understand that, of course, if you're a decent person, you're not actually trying to do this. You're not out there sort of suggesting that documented racial health inequities from coronavirus, right, grounds a sense of biological inferiority. I'm not saying anybody out there is doing it, but part of the point when we think about the weight of history is that it has a life and a function that goes well beyond our intentions. And this is sort of important to think about in intellectual history. It's a basic axiom in intellectual history to say that ideas are social actors, right? They can move things regardless of what we intend, regardless of what you may intend if you are a public health scientist or an epidemiologist, right? Or any other kind of public health professionals part of the workforce, right? And so you might not, if you are part of a study, a program which is documenting these racial health inequities, I would suggest that being aware of the history and the historically problematic ways in which these statistics have been used to ground these ideas of biological essentialism and biological inferiority is part of our basic anti-racist obligations. Like, this is where I think we all need to come from. And if we are coming from that standpoint and that vantage point, then we also have the additional obligation to remind, to point out every time we see these kinds of racial health inequities, right, in the pandemic or in any other kind of health condition or exposure with which we're actually studying, you know, our obligation is to point out and to remind people that what we are seeing is the downstream effect of racism. Full stop. That's what it is, right? This is where this is coming from, the downstream effect of centuries of domination, oppression, and subordination, right? We can't just document the health inequities and sort of let them sit out there themselves, because the scripts, the problematic scripts of which they are part, they are old, they are strong, they are powerful, and they persist even in the face of the best scientific and epidemiologic understandings that we have. And so that's sort of, I guess, if I had a plea for us going forward, what can we be doing here? This would be part of it. Making sure when we're talking about these health inequities, we're always really referencing racism. We're always really referencing structure and identifying that as the prime causal factor where the evidence supports it, which I think it mostly does. Okay. So I'm going to stop there and we'll get to the Q&A. Thanks everybody for attending. I really appreciate it. And of course, feel free to contact me offline if you'd like to talk about any of this further. Thanks. I'm still sharing, sorry. I'm still working on dual screen stuff, so let me try. There we go. Okay, I think we're here now. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Daniel. So currently we don't have anything in the chat box. At this point, we